This is a Seeking Delphi special edition, South by Southwest 2018 minicast, The Endless Impossibilities of Quantum Computing, featuring Whurley. Recorded on site in Austin, Texas, March 12, 2018. I'm Mark Sackler. The future lives here. William Hurley, aka Whurley, is a technology guru and entrepreneur. He is somebody who is inventing the future. His keynote address on quantum computing, the highlight of the Intelligent Future track at South by Southwest, and the culmination of IEEE's Tech for Humanity series, packed the largest ballroom in the Austin Convention Center. With IEEE's kind assistance, I was able to sit down with him afterwards for this exclusive interview. I am with technologist and entrepreneur extraordinaire, William Hurley, known better as Whurley. Thank you for joining me.
Hey, thank you for having me.
So the first thing I want to ask you about in terms of quantum computing, which was what you talked about at your keynote at South by today, is, I'm looking at your history. You started with big companies, you moved to smaller, and then you're starting companies. What is it in the last couple of years that created a passion for you about quantum computing?
So I've been watching quantum computing for about 3 to 5 years. And I've been really tracking it for the last couple of years, almost, little after I started on a dollar. I always, as an entrepreneur, like to know the next two or three things that I might start a company on or work on. And so for me, it was robotics, biohacking, and quantum. So I've been watching all of those. And when I decided, hey, I'm going to go out and do another startup, I looked at everything and I thought, where I can make the most impact, where things are the most interesting intellectually, and where I think the timing is right in the market is quantum computing.
Now, your talk today was entitled The Endless Impossibilities of Quantum Computing. I can't figure out whether that's redundant or an oxymoron, a little of both. What do you mean by the endless impossibilities?
So actually, what we mean is there's all of these things that we think of as impossible, right, that computers could do. Some people think AI is impossible. Some people think, we'll never be able to do certain things with drug discovery and individualization of drugs and all of these different things. And so instead of saying, these are all the possibilities, I thought, we could be kind of clever and tongue-in-cheek about it and say, here are all the impossible things that this could probably bring about.
That's interesting. You said that we should all be fascinated with quantum computing. Why?
Because, I think that this is a moment in time. It's a very special moment in time. I mean, if you think back to when the mainframes came into existence, or, the best example for me is the Homebrew Computer Club, right? If you think back to those days, I think the people in quantum today are kind of like the people that were in the Homebrew Computer Club back in the day. And so this is a movement. This is a very special moment in time where this new technology that has been, roots all the way back to the 1830s and Ada Lovelace is finally at an inflection point where it's going to become important. And in 20 years and 30 years and 40 years, I think we'll be reading stories about all the people I'm working with and that we're at the session today, because then they'll be, the pioneers or the visionaries or the people who did really, really cool stuff. Because I think the time is now. And because of that, I think it's absolutely fascinating. I'm fascinated with it, and I think everybody else should be too. Computing will change more in the next 10 years than it has in the last 100.
Another thing you talked about today was humanizing quantum computing. What exactly does that mean? I mean, it's a pretty arcane technology to most of us.
So what that means to me, okay, is that right now, think about back in the day when you learned how to program a computer. You had to be an electrical engineer because you had to understand the voltage between the gates. Then you had to understand the gates. Now most of these developers running on South by may not even know that computers have gates. Okay. Right now you have to be a physicist to program a quantum computer. I want to take that to the next phase, to where we can expand that circle to a lot wider audience, to a much larger group. To do that, I have to take this incredibly complex topic. Remember, I'm not a physicist. I'm certainly not a theoretical physicist. I'm not a theoretical mathematician. I'm not a discrete mathematician. And I have to take all of these incredibly technical, incredibly complex topics and find a way to get the masses of developers that have the ability to write software to understand enough of them to start trying to write quantum computing software. That's important because of this. Think about back to the iPhone. Nokia already had an app store. We already had capacitive screens. The iPhone got put together, and all of a sudden, there was this explosion of apps and solutions. You know, it doesn't matter if it's Uber, TurboTax, or whatever the case may be, a bunch of apps and a bunch of things that, for better or worse, came out of that. We don't have that in quantum computing. There's Shor's algorithm and Grover's algorithm. There's a quantum zoo you can go check out. But there's not a killer app for quantum. And I believe that's because right now it remains in the realm of the physicist. It's like Prometheus and fire, right? Right now the physicists have the fire, and I want to try to take that to everybody and then not die and have my guts eaten over and over for eternity, because that sounds horrible. But, you know, that's what I mean when I say humanizing, is bringing it down, lowering the barriers to entry, and getting more people comfortable with the concepts and comfortable with working with this concept.
How do we do that, and how far away is it?
Well, I've just started a new company called Strangeworks to focus all of my time and attention on that. So I hope it's not in the too distant future. I think that's a 3 to 5 year plot. We just announced today a deal with beta with Stack Overflow, which is where all developers go to, you know, learn about code and writing code, to where we have quantumcomputing.stackexchange.com, which is the place where everybody can go and ask questions and get answers and start playing around with some of the tools that are available. So hopefully that will be the beginning of a movement over the next few years. We'll grow from dozens of developers into hundreds or hundreds of thousands of developers.
Now, the technology in terms of environmentally, it requires, quantum computing requires that needs a very cold and a very isolated environment to prevent decoherence. You know, this is not something that's going to be on a consumer's desktop. Will consumers en masse use it, or at least be cognizant of some point of quantum computing, or is it just going to run quietly in the background without any realization on the part of most people that it's there?
So they'll absolutely use it, and I'll tell you how. Because quantum computers could be better, things like Grover's algorithm and search, Google will have quantum computers to improve searches and search results and deal with data. And so if you're a user of Google, then you will indirectly be using those quantum computers, right? And that's just one example. You may get customized drugs in the future, probably the product of some, you know, future quantum computing technology. So yeah, I do think it will touch consumers in mass and affect all of our lives, which is yet another reason to be kind of fascinated with it and to be interested in it.
Okay, I'm gonna challenge you here now. I've read recently, and Bo Ewald of D-Wave confirmed this to me in a podcast I did earlier this week, that we don't really know everything yet that quantum computing will be able to do. So you're an imaginative guy. Is there anything you can imagine it doing now or in the next several years that nobody's talking about right now?
So first of all, I wanna start by saying Bo is one of my best quantum buddies, and I love that guy. And has been tremendously helpful in my quantum journey. He's a super, super cool dude. And he's absolutely right. We don't know. And the answer is no. In fact, the whole purpose of starting Strangeworks, the whole purpose of what I'm doing, is not to know. I don't want to be the hero that comes up with the solution for quantum computing or the killer app. I want to build the tools that empower 10 heroes, 100 heroes, 1,000, 100,000, a million people out there who will be at the intersections of these really cool big problems and this technology. And if we can democratize it and we can lower the barrier to entry, then they will produce these things that you're asking about.
You were giving out a book today that kind of fascinated me. Okay. Because in one of my blogs a few years ago, I reviewed a book called How to Teach Quantum Mechanics to Your Dog, which was pretty interesting. And it was kind of simplified, but this kind of went beyond that. This was quantum computing for babies. Tell us a little bit how that came about and how you developed it and what the value of the book is.
So that's a great story that I've told a lot, and I wish I was getting tired of telling the story, but I'm not. It because what happened was a friend of mine posted Chris Ferry's series of books on my website, on my Facebook, and said, "You should get these for my son Julian." And I got him, and Julian was reading him, and he was looking really cool. Like, he was, like, reading Quantum Optics for Babies, and he was, like, flipping through it, like, very intently. And so I took a photo of him, and I ended up mailing it to Chris Ferry, who's the author of this series. And then over the course of time, to keep a long story short, Chris and I kind of became friends and started talking about working on some books together. And we said we should do Quantum Computing for Babies. So fast forward, we now got a book contract. We've now got a, you know, this spreadsheet that he uses to put together the books. And I'm like, you know, pour a rum and coke in the kitchen and tell my wife, leave me alone for a couple hours. I got to go knock out this kid's book. And now fast forward 9 weeks later, I'm like, oh my God, this kid's book. You know, you're talking to editors and like, you know, Entanglement has so many letters in it. And, you know, this page looks great, but we really like to keep it to 3 to 5 words per page. And so trying to boil quantum computing down to that simple a thing was one of the hardest things I've ever done. And actually has been a huge learning exercise for me on my quantum computing journey.
That's a great story. Are there any questions that me or anyone else out there should be asking about quantum computing and aren't?
You know, I think people are asking questions, but maybe they're focused on the wrong questions. Things like, oh, it's going to break encryption. How's it going to break encryption? How's it going to break Bitcoin or blockchain or whatever? I don't think these are the right questions. I think you make the key leak longer, and I have to have even more qubits, and I think you could probably far easier for you to make your key leak longer than it is for me to go from 72 qubits to 200 qubits, right? And security is a journey, not a destination. So I think there's a lot of questions people ask about that. The questions I think they aren't asking is, how do I... interface? How do I interact? How do I learn more about this technology? Whether they're from a consumer standpoint, whether they're a developer, but especially developers or CIOs, I do not travel around the world and see enough CIOs thinking about quantum computing. And so let's give you a scenario. Okay, forget the encryption doomsday scenario. Realistic, real-world scenario. All right? You're in finance. You're CIO of some big bank. Remember Michael Lewis's book, Flash Boys, and how high-frequency trading back in the day was this strategic advantage? And for a while, you know, people were heading off trades of the past, making all this money, et cetera, et cetera. I think quantum will do that to the finance industry. So if you're a finance CEO, I definitely think you'd think about it. Now, why aren't people asking these questions? Why aren't they thinking about it? That's the real question. And let me explain. If you are a CIO and you Google, you see D-Wave has 2,048 qubits. And then you see IBM celebrating 50 qubits. And you're like, wait, I don't understand it. And then you see a report by D-Wave that they're so much faster. And you see Scott Aronson or Helmut Katzgraber or one of these guys write a thing that says, actually, we did the math and we can do almost the same on a classical computer. That's confusing. And so, you know, what I've recently done is I've been an IEEE member for a while, but I joined an effort and started the Quantum Computing Standards Work Group to first do nomenclature standards so that people like you and I and these CIOs can get an idea of, okay, this is what these terms mean, and now I can compare them, and then to move into benchmarking standards so that you can have an objective third-party way. We can say, okay, quantum computer is not 1,000,000 times faster, but it is 100,000 times faster. Or maybe it's 100,000 times faster, but it costs 2,000,000 times as much. So, you know, we don't want to use it, right? But the questions, you know, again, to summarize your question, I don't think enough CIOs, I don't think enough people in technology, in the business of technology, are asking any questions, let alone the right questions, about something that is going to not, you know, in my presentation today, we showed this slide where it was like patents are going, they're really low, like a trend line at the bottom of a graph, and then all of a sudden spike. And we showed investments, trend line, and then spike. And we see this spike across patents, across innovation labs, across universities who have programs, et cetera, et cetera. You start realizing, like, hey, maybe this thing is taking off. And what's going to happen is quantum's not going to be something 20 years out. Quantum's going to start affecting people 3 to 5 years out, in my opinion. And it's going to start affecting people in a way that happens seemingly overnight. It's going to be like, oh, I'm at finance, and some hedge fund has a quantum thing, and they've been doing all this crazy stuff, and I just found out about it. I better get on that bandwagon. But with this, because of the environmental stuff, because of the complexity, because of the developer, it takes me way longer to catch up. So you have to Wayne Gretzky this thing. You need to be playing where the puck is at, not, you know, where it's going, not where it's at, or else you're going to be in a lot of trouble.
So this podcast is first and foremost about the future. Now, you talked about where we're going to be in 50 years. That's a little long-term for me at my stage of life. I want to know what I'm going to see, say, in the next 10 years.
That's not true, right? Didn't you recently interview Audrey DeGray?
Well, I did, but just in case. Just in case that doesn't come through.
Okay,
you know,
okay.
Tell me, but I think also 50 years out is pretty hard to call, but you're on top of it. What do you think I'm going to see in the next 10 years?
In the next 10 years, I think you'll see kind of the holy grail right now, which is a general-purpose quantum computer. That means a quantum computer that works far more resiliently than the ones today, that works in probably a circuit gate model, which works more like you think of a computer, how it works today, that is the foundation on which I think a world of new technologies and discoveries will be based.
That's outstanding. Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks
much
for having
appreciated.
Me.
As Whurley mentioned, he's heading IEEE's working group on quantum computing. With that combination, the possibilities are indeed endless. Many thanks to Interpros and IEEE for making this interview possible, and thank you for joining me. Until next time, I'm Mark Sackler.